As-salamu alaykum. Peace be unto you. I'm Brother Mandeen T. Muhammad, welcoming you to another edition of the Munir Muhammad Show. This is a Crow TV production with you in mind. We are streaming live. The number to call in is 773-434-6625, 773-434-6625. If you want to check us out via social media, which I hope you are doing already, please like and share via our Facebook page. Follow us on Facebook, like and share it. Also on YouTube, like, share, and subscribe. That way you'll be notified every time we go live with another great show. Also, a program note, we Crow will be doing our monthly film showing this November, the 19th of November at 2 p.m. This will be part two of the Violet Drive series. Buzz Anderson interviews the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. That will be at 2 p.m. at Crow 2435 West 71st Street. So just wanted to make sure I get that out. We'll talk more about that later. But again, I just want to remind you, 773-434-6625 is the number to call in. Joining me this evening is no stranger to the show. She's a friend of our organization and of the show. She has an extensive resume, and I'm just so excited to be able to talk to our dear sister, Ms. President Karen Freeman Wilson, President, CEO of the Chicago Urban League. Good evening, President. How are you this evening?
Assalamu alaikum. It is great to be with you.
Yes, ma'am. It is such an honor.
How you doing, Brother Muhammad?
I'm doing great. I'm excited to be able to talk to you. You know, I was reminiscing, looking at a few pictures when we first encountered you. You were the mayor of Gary, Indiana. But you certainly didn't start off as mayor. Your resume, to say it's impressive, would be insulting. I mean, let me say, I preface that by saying, to be the president and the CEO of the Urban League is not lightweight. But looking at your resume, you could have went to anything else, you know, with that type of resume. You know, a Harvard grad, attorney general in Indiana, the mayor of Gary, Indiana. A lawyer. I'm leaving out some stuff. You were the circuit court judge in Gary also. You got
City extensive. City court, yes, sir. Yeah. I was a municipal judge. Think night court.
Night court. Yes, ma'am. I remember night court.
Yes.
But you have an extensive background in, like I said, for the Urban League, the Chicago branch, to get you. They definitely pulled a coup. Because they have quite a talent there. And, you know, I say that, but you came in during, I think at the beginning of the pandemic also. You became president in 2020, is that right?
I did. And, you know, let me just say, I've been extremely blessed and have enjoyed a variety of things, been honored to do a variety of things, but by far leading with the team at the Chicago Urban League is the best yet.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
So it was an opportunity for me to come to Chicago and join the league. And I joined 2 months before COVID set in. Mm. And I remember sitting with our team in March and thinking that it was just gonna be a short-term event. You know, I said, well, we'll take this March vacation, we'll be back and we'll keep going. Mm-hmm. And, you know, about a week in, it was very clear that it was going to be a lot more than a 1 week or 2 week or even 1 month time off. And we immediately began to modify the way we did business and delivered services.
Yes, ma'am. I have to ask you, because certainly you could have went. You could have went national. You could have did, you know, went the corporate route and just went ahead and just made a lot of money and just enjoyed your family and everything. But what was it about this position at the Chicago Urban League that just drew you in? And don't just certainly wasn't just Chicago, because it's not like you was, you know, leaving for better weather. So what was it about the Chicago Urban League?
You know, it was really the opportunity to continue serving. And to continue serving in areas that I am passionate about, and entrepreneurship, housing, workforce development, leadership development, youth and family services, financial empowerment. Those are the areas that we engage in at the league every day. The fact that there was a research and policy shop that was dedicated to improving the lives of Black people was also an attraction. Mm-hmm. And the fact that I didn't have to worry about garbage or potholes another day in my life.
Yes, ma'am.
Was the most exciting part about it.
Mm. Yes, ma'am. So, and like I said, you had a plethora of experience. What were some of those nuggets from being the mayor and attorney general and the other positions that you were able to utilize in your present role as the president and CEO?
I think that one of those things was just the ability to engage in a variety of services. We certainly did that in the AG's office. You do it in City Hall every day. And so the fact that the Chicago Urban League serves everyone from young people in eighth grade to seniors over the age of 80 was familiar. Mm. It was familiar territory. And it really teaches you that you have to take the time to understand the needs of every constituency. Mm-hmm. When we serve people who are just from a variety of places, a variety of neighborhoods,
yes, ma'am.
A variety of income, demographics, and we need to understand, and probably the best example of that is the work that we have been doing in the vaccine awareness, vaccine space.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you this, because a big concern is with our young people, and of course, the Urban League has been around for decades on top of decades. Is there like a youth movement within the Urban League as far as encouraging them to utilize and to be involved more with the organization?
Very much so. So we have youth in a variety of places. One, we have a metro board, and that's really directed at young people between the ages of 22 and 35. Mm-hmm. And they have all kinds of activity. In fact, they're having something on the 12th around Wakanda, the movie.
Okay.
But our young people, they serve in the community. They do Thanksgiving giveaways, Christmas giveaways. They do business development. They do a variety of things. So that's our sort of young adult board that got all kinds of awards from the National Urban League.
Yes, ma'am.
But then we also service youth through our programming. So we service youth all the way from middle school up and through college. In fact, in 2 weeks, we're going to do what we refer to as our fall fly-in,
okay.
where we will be taking young people to Houston, Texas, to look at schools, but also to spend time in the home offices or headquarters of BP Amoco.
Okay. Nice, nice. So never a dull moment. I see you're always keeping busy. But speaking of businesses with BP Amoco, I know you all have a program or some type of structure where you help out small businesses or businesses in the communities, right?
We do. So we have a Center for Entrepreneurship and Innovation. And that center helps businesses all the way from ideation to or startup to the area where they're looking to get to the next level and really develop their business strategy, get financing, do other things that are needed when you get to a certain level in your business.
Mm-hmm.
And we are even adding now, we had it before, but we're bringing it back, a youth entrepreneurship component,
okay.
which we're really excited about because we know that our young people are so entrepreneurial.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. And do you, I guess things are starting to open up gradually you know, we're not, I can't say post-COVID, but people are a little more active right now. So, and you say you're bringing that back. So it seemed like it's more activity. Is there more, do you have more of your people working away from the office? Are they more involved? Are they starting to slowly come back to the office now? Or is everybody
people
still remote?
People are in the office. Not only are our team members in the office, but folks who are coming to engage with our services, ask questions. Our office is bustling now.
Yes, ma'am.
And
yes.
It's exciting to me.
Yes, ma'am.
It's exciting. Now, you know, don't get me wrong. Like so many other organizations, we'll work a little differently after COVID. Hmm. You know, we're not looking for people to be in the office every day of the week.
Okay.
But, you know, to the extent that we are an outward-facing organization, the public is in our building every day.
Okay. Okay. So it's definitely public-friendly then.
Yes.
So so here we are. We're coming up on, this is the 61st annual Fellowship Gala.
It is.
61 years. Yes, ma'am. So when is it? What do we have to look forward to this year?
So this year, and I have to tell you, we just put sold out on the website. Before I was on the call with you, we were trying to figure out if there were any seats in the room, and we cannot find any. But this year, our 61st annual GFD, and it's subtitled Get in League with Us. So we're trying to get people to essentially work with us as we serve our community. We will be honoring Nicole Hannah Jones, Dr. Helene Gale, Dr. Walter Massey. We're very excited about that. We will also enjoy the entertainment of Charlie Wilson.
Is that right?
And, you know, one of the things that has really struck me about Charlie Wilson is that I have had folks from 20 to 80 talk about how excited they are to see that Charlie Wilson is going to be at the gala.
Yes, ma'am.
He has just transcended the test of time over decades, from the Gap Band, you know, when I first met Charlie Wilson, to now where he is with Snoop or some of the other hip hop artists. And, you know, he's not a spring chicken, but he still got it.
Yeah, that definitely shows longevity, and also he's able to adapt to the times.
Yes.
And still stay relevant. So that's very important. Well, unfortunately for a lot of people, the tickets are sold out, which is good for you all, but
yes.
I'm pretty sure people can still donate. But what are those people that may be their first time attending that did have the honor of being able to purchase a ticket, what do they have to look forward to? You know, at one of the Urban League Gala dinners?
Well, it's a good time. Most folks don't sit down long. They might get a quick bite, but it is just nonstop. And this year, and of course, you know, it's a black tie gala. Hmm. So the discussion all week has been, what are you wearing?
Yeah.
Have you gotten your dress? But it's also an opportunity for people to understand, you know, just what it is the Urban League does. I mean, everyone understands that the league is a longstanding partner organization in the community, over 106 years old, but you get a chance through the presentations at the gala to see and understand what we do in workforce, what we do in housing and financial empowerment, what we do in leadership development, what we do in youth and family services, and how we work in the entrepreneurship space to really pursue our mission, which is to reduce the racial wealth gap and to fight for equity and justice for Black people.
Yes, ma'am. And do we seem like we're making grounds in those efforts now?
You know, we are going to come out in the next month or so with the State of Black Chicago, and I'd love to sit and talk about that because it's complicated. You know, there are places and instances where you can see progress, right? But in so many ways, the divide is growing, and it's something that's particularly been exacerbated by COVID. When you think about the educational loss, the learning loss that our young people suffered during COVID, when you think about the challenges that we see in unemployment, you see a very low unemployment rate in the white community, and even the Latinx community, it's lower than with Black people. And, you know, what I always say to folks is you don't always see the full measure of Black unemployment because there are folks who never started looking. You know, the unemployment index that's published by the federal government is for people who go to the office or go online or do all of those things, right?
Yes, ma'am.
There are Black folks who never even started that process who are out of work.
Yeah.
And so that's something that's important to consider, and that's what we work to combat every day.
You know, it was a report done, what they call it, the Great Resignation.
Yes.
Do you see the effects of that in the Urban League? I know you had mentioned about a lot of people, and we talked about the businesses and people starting businesses. Do you see the effect of the Great Resignation in your role there?
Oh, certainly. We've seen it over the last 3 years. And initially, early on, it was because folks didn't have a choice. Children were being educated at home. Children were not going to school. So you had to have an adult there to supervise that process if you did not have older children that you felt comfortable leaving younger children with. Then it got to a point where people, after being sheltered in place for a year, not working in some instances, began to really take a critical look at what was important to them, how much they would be willing to sacrifice to lose time with their family, you know, how little or what their worth was in terms of their hourly rate wage. Some people went back to school. So you can't always go to school and work. You had all of those factors coming together. I think in the last 6 months, people have been returning to work, and we are seeing the impact of the Great Resignation a lot less. But during the first, from 2020 well into 2021, you absolutely saw that. And that's why you saw wages go up.
Yes, ma'am.
That's why you saw, you know, food establishments saying, hey, we will pay dishwashers or, you know, people who aren't necessarily skilled $20 an hour.
Yeah.
They didn't have a choice.
Yeah.
Which I think, you know, if you think about really people being able to support their families, that was one of the silver linings of COVID.
Yeah.
That you didn't have to have a union fighting for you. The market allowed you to get a larger wage. And so you don't have to work two jobs, as an example.
Yeah. No, I bear you witness. It was a lot of restaurants in particular, they were just begging. I mean, you just were a customer. They just want to know, look, do you have anybody that's looking for a job? You know, we need to hire. You know, some places weren't even able to stay open. You had to get your food through the door because they just didn't have enough people inside. So, yes, and you could benefit, like you said. It could, that is definitely the silver lining of that. But look, I know we only had a limited amount of time with you. And like I said, the gift and the curse, the gift is that the gala is sold out, unfortunately. Is it going to be streamed live? Are the people able to see it virtually?
We are going to stream it, and there is an after party for the Night Owls.
Oh.
And the after party is going to be pretty cool. We're going to have DJ Illa, who's the DJ for the Bears. We're going to have Three Snaps, DJ Three Snaps.
Okay.
A young woman who's a very popular DJ. We're going to have Wendy Indy, the hip-hop violinist.
Okay.
So we're, and it's going to be hosted by our board chair, Suzette McKinney, Dr. Suzette McKinney, and LaRoyce Hawkins, who most people know as Kevin Atwater from Chicago PD.
Yeah. Nice, nice. Look like you generated a phone call. You got time to take a phone call before you go?
Oh, sure, I'll take a call.
Caller, you're on the air with President Freeman Wilson.
Assalamu alaikum, Brother Mandy.
Wa alaikum salam, ma'am.
And greetings to the president. I have a question. She had mentioned about small businesses or people starting business that don't have a good idea or have a great idea, and they would assist them. A lot of people have ideas, and they say they oftentimes mention it to someone, and those ideas get stolen, and they don't get the credit. How can a person come to you with an idea from start to finish, and if you got some kind of examples of that process or some success story? Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
That's an excellent question. The first thing we do in our next one, our next startup class, is to tell people how to protect their ideas. There are some products that are protected by trademarks. There are some products that, or some ideas that are protected by copywriting.
Mm-hmm.
But the first thing we encourage folks to do and instruct people on and support people in is protecting their intellectual property and any part of their idea that's proprietary.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. We got one other call. I know Miss Willington is going to give me for this one, but let me go.
You know, that's between you and Chelsea. I'm sitting here.
I can hold my own then. Call you on the air with President Freeman Wilson.
Hey, brother. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Good evening to your guest. You know, one of my favorite nights was when I was in Gary, Indiana, with Munir Muhammad, and they were giving accolade to Mayor Gary Hatcher for his work in Gary in the early 60s, 70s, and it was just a great evening. You know, I was so happy to just get close to Mayor Gary Hatcher, the mayor of Gary Hatcher. Hmm. But that night, Richard, we went straight downtown to the Urban League Gala. I had an even better day because I saw Babyface and a lot of politicians with another election year. And so, I would certainly, I hear you say the ticket sold out, but I certainly wish I can stick a toe in there or just listen outside the door or something, because I tell you, y'all have a really good time down there. Thank you for coming on board the show.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, he's trying to ease his way on in there on Saturday night.
You know, if I had a dollar every week this week for everybody who's called me, I could just have a really nice meal. Let me just say that. But, you know, I'm glad he raised and talked about Mayor Hatcher. I had the honor of knowing him from the time I was a 7-year-old.
Mm.
And hearing him during his first campaign talk about his dreams and aspirations for the city. You know, I remember one of the last things he said to me, and it was on the day that we dedicated the statue in his honor.
Mm-hmm.
It was, he said, there's life after being a mayor.
Yeah.
It was after the election. I had lost the election. And he said, you know, you've done a great job. There's life after being a mayor. And, you know, you just have to live that life. And it meant so much coming from him.
Yes, ma'am.
And just over the course of my time in office, having access to his counsel. And I think that the thing that I learned from him and have tried to carry throughout my life is the importance of accessibility. So many people get hung up with their own titles, right?
Yes, ma'am.
President, mayor, governor, whatever. Mm. But at the end of the day, people are people, right?
Correct.
And I'm not really worried about what my title is. And I don't want people to worry about it. I want people to be able to talk to me about what their needs are, what their challenges are, and for me to help them think through how we might solve them together. And that's something that Mayor Hatcher taught. He was always accessible to kids. I remember, you know, once I met him as a seven-year-old, I thought he belonged to me throughout his life.
Yes, ma'am.
And you know, so as a 10-year-old, I would see the mayor. Hey, there's the mayor. And I'd take off running towards him. My mother was like, would you leave the mayor alone? He's too busy. But he always took time. He had a youth foundation. He had a track team that traveled nationally, a scholarship foundation that changed lives of many, many citizens at that time. Mm. And that's just who he was. And to have that in my memory,
yes, ma'am,
really influenced the type of mayor that I wanted to be.
He definitely was a trailblazer and an icon. Yeah. And I recall when he had that that conference or that summit with the under black leaders in
1972.
Yep, and of course the messenger Elijah Muhammad was a part of that as well. So he's definitely part of that history.
Minister.
Oh yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
Absolutely love the minister.
Yes, ma'am. So, but that's great. And it's great to for you to be able to reminisce and still hold those memories close to heart.
Yes.
So, but look, I really want to thank you so much for your time this evening. This is an abbreviated segment, but definitely we're going to have you back because it's a lot. Durbin League is doing a lot. It's a lot going on, and I know you have a lot more announcements that'll be coming up. So, you got about 35 seconds to give us a closing statement.
What I will say is thank you so much for having me on. I do want to direct folks to our website. On November 9th, we are having a session about how to become an appraiser for those who are interested in becoming a real estate appraiser. We think that it's important. We know about appraisal bias, and one way to address that is to get more appraisers who look like us. So
correct.
I
yes,
hope
ma'am.
That it's in person at the league at 6 o'clock on November 9th. So
and
that's a week from today. A week from today.
Yes, ma'am. But that's an excellent point because that's a whole nother segment right there. You know, appraisers were going, they don't look like us. They're going to a home and see that it's black people that live there. And then, you know, they're undervaluing. And then you switch it up and see some pictures of some people that look like them. And then the value goes up. So, but that's a whole nother segment. And definitely we're going to have you to come back and talk about that.
I'd love to.
Yes, ma'am.
I would love to.
Definitely looking forward to
it. Yeah, but I just want your listeners to come out to the league. They can find the registration link on our website, chiul.org. And we would love to host them.
Yes, ma'am. Well, look, I'm going to try.
There's going to be dinner.
Oh, well, you said it right there. If nothing else, they're coming for the dinner. But look, speaking of dinner, I'm going to try to see if I can press my luck and ease my way on in there Saturday night. So hopefully I see you in passing, man.
Good luck with that.
Yeah. Hey, I come from the school of Jesse Jackson and Munir Muhammad. Just act like you belong. So, but look, thank you so much for coming in to see you, my dear sister. And I know you got another appointment. You enjoy your evening and you be safe. And I'll see you soon.
Please give regards to Brother Munir as well. And it's great to see you, Mandy.
Okay. Thank you, man.
All right. Take care now.
You have a good evening. All right. We're going to take a break and we'll be back with another interesting guest.
Our mission? Help kids reach their fullest potential. Our biggest obstacle? A few years ago, it was to get state government to pay our invoices. Under Bruce Rauner, we were owed hundreds of thousands of dollars. Everybody's job was at risk. But J.B. Pritzker has helped turn things around. Now the state pays bills on time. JB understands that in order for me to do my job, he has to do his job. I used to spend my time worrying about how we were going to keep our doors open. And now I spend my time thinking about our kids.
Talk on the governor's race.
Darren Bailey, I met the man. He's a family farmer. Somebody who understands what it's like to go to work every day. Somebody who's fair-minded. I can trust this guy. Yeah, farmer from Southern Illinois. Yeah. A farmer from Southern Illinois.
It's amazing how something this small is so huge for our economy. These chips power our smartphones, our cars, our military equipment. But foreign companies dominate chip manufacturing, causing the supply chain crisis, threatening our national security. It's why I helped pass the CHIPS Act, to bring high-tech chip manufacturing home. America can power our own economy and create hundreds of thousands of new jobs doing it. I'm Tammy Duckworth, and I approve this message.
Commissioner Dennis Deere declared racism, gun violence, and mental health all public health crises. As a result, Commissioner Deere helped to ensure fairness throughout Cook County, creating the position of its first Chief Equity Officer. The county budget allocated $1 million to address trauma from gun violence and $60 million specifically for mental health. For leadership, dedication, and advocacy, the choice is clear. Re-elect Dennis Deere, Cook County Commissioner.
Vote now. This ad is paid by the Friends of Dennis Deere.
Janulius. As treasurer, he ran one of the most ethical anti-corruption government offices in the country. Now running for Secretary of State, Janulius is endorsed for his strong record of public service, a slate of modernization ideas, and a plan to get rid of the time tax Illinoisans pay standing in endless government lines.
I told you all that I wasn't running to be something, but to do something. I want to make this state and the Secretary of State's office the best in the nation.
Searching for a restaurant that serves delicious home-cooked meals at an affordable price like your grandmother used to make? Well, the search is over. Stop by MacArthur's, the new talk of Chicago. We offer a warm atmosphere with friendly service and excellent meals ranging from carryout, dine-in, or catering for your special events. MacArthur's is open 7 days per week from 11 a.m. until 9 p.m. Come visit us at
5412
West Madison Street or call us at 773-261-2316.
And we are back. I'm Brother Mandeen T. Muhammad. Thanks for hanging with us. I want to thank President Freeman Wilson of the Chicago Urban League for spending a little time with us and letting us know about the gala this weekend. I guess it's good for them that they are sold out, but I'm pretty sure they will still accept donations if you're feeling good about yourself. If you are feeling good about yourself, you feeling generous and beneficent, don't forget about us over here at Crow. Definitely is an investment for you to help us continue doing what we do here, especially as far as the TV shows that give us a platform and give you a platform to come on and get your message out. And also as the archives for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, having the most extensive collection, you know, we have to be able to preserve and make sure that all of the under record is well maintained and well kept. And also, you know, we're in the building, so, you know, you got to look at upkeep. So it's not going to take care of itself. So absolutely, look at us as an investment, and as I always say, help Crow before you need help from Crow. Again, this is a live interactive show. The number is 773-434-6625. You saw the commercial during the break. Crow will be having our annual monthly, I should say, free film showing. It would be this November the 19th. It's a Saturday, 2 p.m. here at Crow, 2435 West 71st Street. Please come on by. It's free. You can't beat that. It's free. We're going to be showing the part two of the Violet Drive interview with Buzz Anderson and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. So with that, we're switching gears. We have now my dear brother, Brother Anthony Williams of Mother Carr's Farm. Yes, sir. How you doing, my brother? Good
I'm
to see you, sir.
Well.
Yes,
thank
sir.
You.
Yes, sir. So summer may be over with, but that don't mean farming is over with, huh?
No. We go... well, for the CSA, which is Community Supported Agriculture, we go till November 19th, which is the weekend before Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. But then if it's still food that's still in the field, like collard greens and kale, which is a more robust vegetable, then we still hit the restaurants and a few select customers that still want to participate.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. But starts in July, ends November 19th.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And I want to make a correction. I said Williams is Williams' son.
Yes, sir.
Let me make sure I correct myself. Forgive me, sir. I was so excited to see you, man.
Yeah.
But, you know, you and Doc, you just got back from Houston from a little, fact-finding mission, I should say.
Yeah, we was out there with Dr. Baxter. He had a whole week of activities and then a gala at the end. He's a cardiologist that has his own clinic, and he mixed traditional medicine, you know, with natural cures and things like that. And it's just really phenomenal, some of the things that he does. You know, we learned a lot. Like, when you go to the doctor, generally your blood pressure is high sometimes, and he'll immediately put you on some medicine there. Mm-hmm. But what Dr. Baxter does, he monitors your blood pressure, where he gets three or four readings a day, and he mm-hmm. baselines it. And then he figure out how he's going to treat your high blood pressure from that. So they've been doing that over in Europe for years, and so that's pretty cutting edge, so that it makes it where he can use less pharmaceuticals, because sometimes might not be necessary.
Yes, sir. So what are some of your takeaways from the trip?
Well, that there, and then at the gala he had on Friday, he had three or four other cardiologists. He had one from Chicago, Kim Williams. I think he practiced down there in Louisville, Kentucky. But he was down, and it was just a lot of great information that we was learning, why it's better to eat, you know, food that's not processed and things like that. And what happens, you know, in the digestive system that really makes us sick. You know, they say one thing, and some of it's true, but really, you know, it's just the inflammation from the food that really causes, I want to say, 60% of the medical problems.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you're saying that food should actually be our medicine?
Exactly. And so basically, a raw diet is at the top top of the chain for what you should eat, and then minimally processed food and least amount of meat as possible. If Dr. Mason was here, he'd be, you know what he'd be saying.
Yeah. Nothing that has parents and nothing that has eyes. Something like that. So,
yeah.
But mm-hmm. talk about, let's go back and give a little, because you're actually the manager.
Yes.
Out there. Is that the correct title?
Yes, yes.
And mm-hmm. so, I mean, but let's go back. How did you even get involved in the first place as far as Mother Carr's Farm, and even as far as farming, period?
Yeah. Well, started as a Vernon Park Church of God vision from Pastor January. He had a desire to grow food on the campus. And I had just graduated from a sustainable program at Wilbur Wright College in 2009. And I wasn't a lot going on in that right now. And so he suggested that I try my hand at growing the food. And so we did it for about a year, year and a half, and we turned into a CSA in 2013. And so this is almost our 10th or 11th year that we've been growing food as a CSA.
What's the CSA?
Community supported agriculture. So that just means that of course the farm is in your community and it should be supported by the community. So what that curtails is that we have a one-time fee. You pay that one-time fee and you get vegetables for every other week through the whole duration, mm-hmm. which generally starts in mid-July and ends in mid-November.
Yes, sir. Yes, yeah. sir. And so obviously this is something that you like to do.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know what? I can see what it does to the community, and then that really, really hypes me up to work even harder. Okay. You know, I see people getting better by eating the food. Then also I see young people that come out and work on the farm, and they learn how to be men and better women. So just seeing that type of growth in people's character and the food is what really drives me.
Yes, sir. I'm always interested in as far as the youth is concerned. So mm-hmm. you mentioned that. So you do have young people. Do they volunteer? They actually work for you?
Well, we have some people that work for us in the summer, you know, from the high school. But we're very involved with the 205 school district in Lansing and Calumet City and Dalton. So we go into those schools sometime. They had a few raised beds that we had helped assist them put in. So we went over there and see how the raised beds was doing and just kind of hung out with the students and talked to them. You know, just show them, you know, that the community is really concerned about them.
Are they receptive?
Yes. And what you have to do, you have to build a relationship. They ain't too receptive at first, you know, but when they see you coming back and that you truly care, then it catches on.
Yeah, because I guess being a farmer is not really a glamorous type. You're not going to see that on Instagram or Facebook, anything as far as being promoted. But mm-hmm. I guess if you break it down to them and let them know that, mm-hmm. you know, we all got to eat, you right. know, food, clothing, and shelter,
yeah.
This is very important, yeah. and it could be something yeah. that could
it's
really
an honorable
benefit
profession.
Them.
It spins off into other things. If you're growing food, you're going to need transportation. Mm-hmm. So, and then you could use process, and then there's a food science aspect to it. And so it's more than just being out there in the field and growing the food. That's just the foundation of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Now, you say there's mm-hmm. a food science aspect of it. Explain that.
Yeah. Well, you have companies like Kraft and things like that. So they take food and, you know, and they put it where, you know, it could be frozen and things like that. So that's where the food science comes in, mm-hmm. and the safety part of it and the processing of the food. And that's where we're trying to go with this next. We're trying to learn how to process our food so where you can use it, you know, pull it out the freezer, put it in the pot, lightly heat it back up, open up the plastic bag. So that's a value-added product.
Mm-hmm. Have any of the young people mm-hmm. that worked up there, have they go on to do something in that field or, you know, come back or even decided to start eating better?
Eating better. And then the education, there's a lot of life lessons learned in that field. You know, I was explaining to my friend, he was out there on the land, so he was swinging at the bee. So I said, you don't really have to defend yourself against that bee. That's a worker bee. She's only out there to collect food for the colony. Mm-hmm. Now, if you go close to the colony, the male bees be hanging out, and those are the ones that attacked you. Mm-hmm. And so And so you can learn a lot about purpose, because every man that's on earth, he has a purpose. And once you get into that purpose, you're going to be better off.
Yes, sir. And you mentioned the bees, so yeah. You all. Mm-hmm.
So they stay in their purpose.
Exactly. But and also with the bees, you all, you know, mm-hmm. How do you utilize the bees in what aspect?
Yeah, a byproduct of bees, of course, is honey. Mm-hmm. And so we extract some of the honey, but we don't extract too much of it because we really use them for the pollination of the plant. By having bees out there, you might raise your yields by 40%, because you have bees are great pollinators.
Yes,
So that's mainly what we use them for, but we do have honey too from time to time.
I don't know if it was a conspiracy, but I did read somewhere that a lot of the bees were dying off or being killed off. Is that some truth to that?
Well, it's not a conspiracy. What it is that there's just a lot of toxins out here that's being emitted in the air, especially from cars and factories, and it messes with their nervous system, and eventually, it distorts them, and they die off.
So. And how would that affect us? You know, as far as you know, the food and us
humans? They're pollinators, and so when you don't have that pollination on the food, you won't get the yields that you should be getting. So
and now, when you say yields, you know, for those of us boys and girls.
Yeah, yields are what's produced from the plant that you grow.
Okay.
So they help raise that yield up. So,
okay.
Mm-hmm. Get your numbers up.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Get your weight up, as they say. It looks like we got a caller. Caller, you on the air with our dear brother Anthony Williamson.
Assalamu alaikum, Brother Mandine and Brother Anthony. This is Sister Amina.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm calling to let him know that I am enjoying experimenting on my new vegetables. And now my body is craving for vegetables now. Mm. And I want to know, will we be able to pick up some honey on Saturday?
Yes, I had that out there for you.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Okay, thank you.
All right.
That's one way of getting your product. Put you on the spot, man.
You know, that's the boss's mama, so you gotta answer that right.
I got you, sir. Hey, but that's great. So, I mean, so how have the community, what kind of response are you getting from the community?
Oh, it's just great. We're growing, vastly, and we're just trying to figure out how we can accommodate more people. And make sure that we able to, people are learning that, just like she said, when you eat like this, you start feeling better. These vegetables, they're fresher than what you get at the grocery store, and I'm not knocking what you get at the grocery store, but when we pull this for the distribution, it's generally done on Friday, and it's picked up on Saturday. Mm-hmm. So it most of it doesn't even end up in the refrigerator.
Yeah, so. I know we were talking earlier, me and a couple of the young crew members, and when they mentioned that, you know, they just ate and it was kind of feeling that itis. Mm-hmm. And I was just making a point that it was a documentary, it may have been Game Changers, I believe. Mm-hmm. They were saying that, you know, if you're eating right and if you're eating, you know, a plant-based diet, it's supposed to give you life. Mm-hmm. You know, and so that, you know, because that the plants are a life food. Life, what is it called? Raw diet?
Yes, a raw diet. That's the way, you know, the Creator, when we first start. See, I use from the Bible. And so the closer that you get to the way that the food was created, the better the food going to be for you. So, mm-hmm. So the more that you do for it. So when they start off in the Bible, they were in the Garden of Eden, they were not cooking anything. Mm-hmm. So you apply the heat to the food or the vegetable, you're going to lose a lot of nutrients. Mm-hmm. And so what you really want to do is get as much of this stuff in you as raw. You know, and especially if you're suffering from any type of ailments.
Yeah, gotcha. Looks like we have another phone call. No. Well, thank you for informing me. So we gonna move on. So, I'm sorry. Do we have a call? Caller, you on the air?
Assalamualaikum, Brother Mandy. And greetings also to Brother Anthony.
Yeah, she was greeting you.
Thank you. Assalamualaikum.
Okay. Yes, Brother Anthony, you were the topic of a conversation today I had. I was at Thornton's Fractional today with my sister, Dr. Redmond.
Oh,
And she showed me the, they have a brand new culinary arts program. And right outside the culinary arts program is where the Raised Beds is supposed to be. Mm-hmm. So they're excited about, obviously, getting that started, growing the food, and then preparing the food in the new kitchen. So they're very excited about that. Yeah. I want to ask you a question as far as the motivation. You spoke a little bit about the youth as programs. A lot of people, like you say, that is some hard work, but it's gratifying work. And when a person does that, that's why the Cook County State's Attorney, no, the Sheriff Department used to have a program that helped the youth when they were incarcerated, and that gave them jobs outside of prison when they got out. Mm-hmm. And so that is extremely beneficial that they have programs like that and what you're doing for the youth. So if you can talk a little bit more in depth about what you plan on doing at Thornton Fractional, I appreciate that. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Actually, we was over there, I think it was Friday, took Dr. Mesa with me, and he sat down and discussed some career choices with the young people. But actually, we've had a relationship with the 205 school district for over 11 years now. Okay. So we've been going inside there. But what we really want to do, we want to reach these kids before they go to prison. Mm-hmm. You know, it's harder after a person been out to been to prison. Your chances of really getting it right, the numbers are, you know, not really that good. So we can touch them and get them pointed in the right direction before they get there. That's our strategy. We had four raised, they have six all together. So we have four raised beds that was actively producing food now. And they did get some to the culinary arts, and some of the students was able to sample some of the food. So we first, you know, we want to get them used to eating a better diet, because a lot of them come in there off of sodas and potato chips in the morning. Flame and that's not a way to start your day. Right. And if you wonder if a person's angry, I'd be angry if that was my diet.
Yeah. You mentioned mm-hmm. raised bed a couple of times. Could you explain what that
Well, raised bed is? We do what we call direct sow. That's when you go directly into the ground with mm-hmm. the seed or the plant. The raised beds, they give you more control. They're taking a piece of wood or whatever, they might use some type of plastic, and you create the environment for the plant, so you're able to add what type of soil you want to use and stuff like that. And it's a great teaching tool, you know, to get people into growing their food. And it's not as extremely labor intense as it is, it's just, you know, going directly in the ground. And so you can use that in tight areas or where the soil might not be up to par. Mm-hmm. And so that's where raised beds come in handy. And, you know, we use them in schools. Sometimes you have them around in nursing homes and things like that where some of the older people can go out and, you know, grow their own food and get out and get fresh air. Because you want to encourage people to be outside as much as possible too. That fresh air and that sunlight is really therapeutic.
Absolutely. As we're closing now, we got a few minutes left. We didn't talk about what we definitely have to talk about. People can actually purchase, like, I don't know, do you call it shares or?
Yeah, we used to call it shares, but then people were getting confused, so we now call it a membership.
So you want them thinking that they own part of the land, huh? So, but let's take this call, mm-hmm. then we'll have you explain more about that. Caller, you're on the air. Caller, you there? No caller. So go ahead and explain, you know, it's no longer shares. They have a membership. And with the membership, what does that entail?
Yeah, that tells you to be able to get vegetables through the whole growing season. We start planting in late March, early April, and the food start coming out the ground in mid-July. We're trying to get that a little bit earlier down to June, but it's mid-July. So every other week for the price of $2.75, which is a half a share and $4.75 for a full share, you're able to get vegetables every other week. And a variety of vegetables like corn, watermelon, string beans, collard greens, kale, Swiss chard, things like that. And it's a lot of stuff that I left off, but probably at least about 26 different vegetables.
That's a lot. That's a lot. And that sounds worth the price. I think the caller's back. Caller, very quickly, you on the air?
Yeah, brother. I just reminded of something. Now, agriculture is, you know, I remember as a youth, fourth, fifth grade, something like that, maybe even third, where they actually made us cut a milk carton out, put the dirt in there and take a seed home and then just watch it grow. Mm-hmm. And that's a real educational experience. And that's basically it in a nutshell.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm really enthralled in the things y'all do, Brother Anthony. So may Allah bless y'all to continue on. Okay, brother?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. So, yeah, that's a good point, though. But very quickly, I know we only got a minute or so left. Why do you think this is not pushed, you know, going back to the earth? Because we all got to eat. I mean, you know, when it comes to our young people, the closest thing to a vegetable is ketchup on a French fry.
Yeah. Like they said, that's a whole different show right there. Yeah. But a lot of it is just part of the agenda, part of the control. You know, one of the most powerful things that you could do is grow your own food. So it gives you a lot of control over yourself and your community. And so sometimes the powers that be, they don't want to see that.
Yeah. Quickly again, and it's close again, got about 45 seconds. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and explain, let the people know again how they can get those shares.
So we'll start accepting applications for shares again in February. You can call the church, 708-753-1975, to get an application. I don't have all the information right now, but I will get it and get it posted again.
Yeah.
Also, the address of the farm is 1975 Joel Road, 604-11 is the zip code. And so you're welcome to come out on any of these Saturdays from here to 19th of November. You can come out and visit.
Wonderful. The music is playing now. I know this is an abbreviated moment. I really appreciate you coming on, my brother. Of course, we always have you, so we're definitely going to have you back.
Yes.
So on behalf of our dear brother Anthony Williamson and President Karen Freeman Wilson, I'm Brother Mandy Muhammad, and on behalf of the Crow TV production, I want to leave you with the greeting words of peace and the paradise of Islam.